It's still very basic. But I also wanted to say that I mainly because I'm Italian, I can understand Spanish quite easily. So if any of you wanna ask questions in Spanish, in the end, I can take those without requiring a translation. So if I can share my slides now. So I guess you can all see my screen now. What I want to present today is the core of my project as a postdoc at the Instituto. It's a project in general on the moral foundations of rights and human rights. I will focus on just rights today, but there's a further component of the investigation, which is specifically about human rights. And I've decided entitling it, "Is There Moral Magic in the World Right? Our Rights, Interests, and Wrongs." So here's the summary of the talk. I'm gonna start because this is a meeting of general philosopher with a short premise about the contemporary theories of legal and moral rights in the scholarship. Then I will start delineating the negative or critical component of my investigation. I will consider I will present two problems that the interest theory of rights encounter. One problem I call the problem of directionality, and it's been identified already in the literature. It's very common referring to it. And the other problem that I'd like to focus on is a problem I call the problem of moral magic. And I will have a look at in the third part of the talk, I will have a look at the solutions to the moral magic problem within the interest theory of rights. Then, and I will show why these solutions actually fail. Then I will notice that the problem of moral magic actually affects not only interest theory of rights, but also some alternative conceptions, such as accounts that are generally grounded in dignity. And finally, I will give a sketch, and it's a very embryonal, preliminary sketch of an alternative solution, solution to the moral magic, to what I call the moral magic problem. Now, there is a classic conflict in contemporary theories of rights, right? So if you open the Stanford Encyclopedia entry on rights or any work, the introductory works in the philosophy of rights, it will start with this classic conflict between interest theories and will theories, which is sometimes even reconnected historically to utilitarianism on the one hand and the ontological theories, Kantianism, on the other. So interest theories of rights are the ones I will focus on. Essentially, they argue that interests are either sufficient or necessary in the definition of a right. But bear with me on this a second, because I'm gonna get on this in detail in the next section. Whereas the will theories generally understand rights as mechanism, as the ontic mechanism by which right holder acquire control over others' duties. So there's a duty, and if there's an agent that is in control of that duty, then there is a right. And we presume that the control of that duty essentially means having the power to decide whether the duty has to be delivered, has to be discharged, or the duty can be waived, annulled, and so on and so forth, right? So that kind of conception of the right holder has led to the metaphor that we find in HLA Hart in a very famous essay by HLA Hart as a right holder, as a small scale sovereign, someone who has a power vis-a-vis a particular duties that are owed to them. The problem that will theories of rights encounter in general is that they seem to lead to many counterexamples when we consider very common rights, very common examples of legal or conventional rights that do not seem to give the right holder this kind of power, this kind of control over the correlated duties. Okay, so just consider the rights of criminal law or constitutional rights, which sometimes coincide. So the right not to be killed is not a right that each right holder has a control over, in the sense that he or she can decide whether the correlated duty, the duty not to kill them, can be discharged or can be waived, annulled, and so on and so forth, ceded to someone else, and so on and so forth. And the same applies to most constitutional rights, and of course, a fortiori, to inalienable rights, which by definition are rights that cannot be alienated or waived or annulled, and so on and so forth. Hart himself recognized this kind of problems, and that's why he understood the will theory of rights as a description of just a part of the realm of rights, the part that coincides with, in general, actual rights, with the rights that we find in private law. So in contemporary scholarship, the few thinkers that still are committed to the will theory of rights generally have some kind of libertarian inclination. They're committed to this image of rights as protecting a sphere of action by giving people powers over duties that are directed to them. But like I said, because of all these issues that the will theory encounters when it tries capturing the practice of rights in its generality, then I'm actually gonna exclude the will theory from my analysis. So let's have a look at the interest theory in detail, and in particular at two very prominent presentations. Now, Joseph Raz in The Morality of Freedom wrote that X is a right if X can have rights, and other things being equal, an aspect of X's well-being, his interest, is sufficient reason holding some other persons to be under a duty. Whereas in a recent formulation, a formulation that is similar to others that he has proposed in the years, Matthew Cramer writes that necessary, though insufficient, for the holding of a legal right by X is that the duty correlative to the right, when actual, normatively protects some aspect of X's situation that on balance is typically beneficial for a being like X. Now, what we can immediately see is that Cramer's definition is much more sophisticated than Raz, right? And aspires to be much more comprehensive. There are significant differences between the two, but two in particular I would like to emphasize, right? There's also a difference that Cramer seems to focus primarily on legal rights, whereas Raz focuses on moral rights in general, but we can ignore that. The most consequential points to emphasize here are the for Cramer, the interest is not sufficient to the justification of the rights, and also the interest is not an interest of the agent, right? Raz writes his interest, so he seems to imply from his definition that the interest of a right holder might be an interest specifically of the right holder, whereas for Cramer, the interest is typically beneficial for a right holder. So what does this imply in practice? So from the fact that Cramer takes the interest to be merely necessary and not only sufficient, we can say that interests for Cramer always figure in the definition of the rights, but they do not just make rights, okay? So whenever we find a right, there must be an interest that that the right is there to protect. To do, it's not every interest makes a right. So something else is needed in order to create and justify a right. And the second most remarking novelty of Cramer's definition is that the interest is only typical of beings in the position of the right holder. So it's not an interest that all right holders necessarily entertain. It's not an interest that every right holder can identify as their own when they consider, you know, the kinds of interests that they think they have. But it's an interest that is merely typical of a particular category of beings that we identify in some sort of way. So there's been further evolution, further progress in this, in the scholarship. And for example, Leibniz has this theory of rights as protecting kind desires, the desires that people have in virtue of occupying a particular role, so in virtue of being of a particular kind. In a recent paper, this guy Julian Junker has providing a contractually, it's a Scanlonian contractualist defense of an interest theory of rights, and has argued that the interests that are protected by rights are interests that generic individuals in particular position could reasonably demand. So the idea is that in Scanlonian contractualism, when we deliberate on which kinds of moral principles are justifiable, right, we consider the interests of generic individuals in certain positions, and if the interest and if it's reasonable that a generic individual demand that their interest is protected in particular circumstances, then we call it a right. Okay, and that's a kind of contractualist interpretation of Scanlonian contractualist interpretation of an interest theory of rights. So to me, the most important point to emphasize here is that the actual interests of right holders, the interests each right holder would identify as their own, play no role in explaining which rights they possess, right? Because the interest is presumed to be the interest of a generic individual in that position and not the interest that all right holders actually possess and claim that they possess. So that was the first feature of our contemporary scholarship that I wanted to point out. Another interesting feature is the question of the directionality or directed duties, which we can see through this famous essay from Joel Feinberg in 1970, in which he imagines a world. It starts with Feinberg imagining a world without rights, and Feinberg writes, "Try to imagine Nowheresville, a world very much like our own, except that no one or hardly anyone has rights." And then he adds this interesting qualification. He says, "Well, just because people do not have rights in Nowheresville, it doesn't mean that everyone behaves immorally. We can imagine that there's a world with duties, no rights." So he says, "Let us try to make Nowheresville more appealing to Kant by introducing the idea of duty into it, and let the sense of duty be a sufficient motive for many beneficent and honorable actions." So there's morality, there's practical reason within Feinberg's Nowheresville, but there are no rights. There are duties, but there are no duties correlated to rights. So which kinds of duties disappear in Nowheresville? And The answer is that the duties that disappear in Noah's will are the duties that we owe to somebody else. We still have the duties that we derive from practical reason or morality in general, or religion, or whatever other source of duties you might consider, but we don't have the duties that we owe to each other. So we don't have what in the current scholarship are called directed duties. The vocabulary is very contains a lot of variety here. There's people that call them personal duties. Directed is the most common, but there's people that call them personal, bipolar, because you know they concern relations between two people. Michael Thompson called them dechaeological, and they are contrasted with the indirected, impersonal, monadic duties of morality in general. So, to sum up about the contemporary scholarship, as I said, the interest theory of rights is probably the most popular explanation of the function and nature of rights. And in the most recent development of the theory, the specific interests of the right holders are irrelevant when determining which rights individuals possess. And the first question in the philosophy of rights now is, why do we need directed duties? Right? Because directed duties, we said, are the duties that we lose, that we eliminate in a world without rights. So the question about the most fundamental question about rights becomes, why do we need directed duties in the first place? Why do we need the language and practice of directed duties in the first place? Or what's wrong with Noah's will, the world without rights and without directed duties? Okay, so this was a summary of the recent development. Now I want to talk about two crucial problems with the interest theory of rights. The first is the problem of directionality itself, of explaining directed duties. So now, how does the interest theory of rights respond to the problem of directionality? And the answer is not greatly. So imagine that the interest theory of rights, right, again, says that the core notion favor in some sort of way an interest of a generic interest of a generic individual. Now imagine that we distributed, we created a pattern of duties that we distributed across the population, undirected duties, so duties that are not owed to somebody else, but that are simply derived from morality and so on. Imagine that we distributed these undirected duties in a way so that they protected the generic individual interest in the same way as directed duties do. So the interest would be equally protected. They just wouldn't be protected in the same way. They wouldn't be protected through rights. They would be protected through undirected duties. Now, would anything change for the right holders? Well, of course, something would change, namely the fact that they are not right holder any longer. So they cannot claim that those interests have to be protected because other people have a duty to them to protect those interests. So something would definitely change, but their interests would be protected in the same manner, at least assuming that people would comply with this undirected duties, the interest would be protected in exactly the same way. So Noah's will, with a perfect distribution of undirected duties, would be a world very different from our own, but at the same time, a world where interest could be protected in exactly the same manner. Now, there is an objection to this that has been argued, and I personally don't find particularly compelling, but you know, I just put it there. Maybe directed duties are more helpful because they add an element of enforcement, because they allow people to claim that certain things are owed to them, and therefore they make the protection of interest more efficient. And my reply to that is that I'm happy to accept this possibility, but this sounds to me as an empirical claim that has to be demonstrated, that the introduction of directed duties adds an element of enforcement that makes the protection of interest more efficient. So my conclusion about this is that interest cannot explain the irreplaceability of directed duties. Okay. So I don't want to contest the fact that interests usually figure in the definition and the justification of rights. But at the same time, if the ultimate purpose of rights is to protect interests, then the fact is we don't actually need rights and directed duties to protect interests. We could protect interests in other ways. So the directionality problem for interest theory of rights. But I want to introduce another different problem, which starts this way. Now one can say, right, that one important role of rights beyond the protection of interest is the fact that only rights can explain that a certain agent has been wronged when a duty that is directed to them has not been discharged. Okay, so when my rights have been violated, when a duty that was directed to me as a right holder has not been discharged, I have been wronged. And only the language of rights can explain that, we can think. Problem. We know from the sophisticated version of the interest theory of rights that rights do not necessarily protect an interest that the right holder can recognize, can easily recognize. They protect, again, generic interests, but not necessarily interests of each individual right holder. Plus, I've always been trying to keep together moral rights, legal rights, conventional rights, and all other things that we call rights in general. And if we wanna look at rights in this very broad manner, then we have to accept that there are conventional rights that protect interests that morally would not require any protection, right? Some conventional, let's agree that conventional rights are supposed to protect an interest, but some conventional rights might protect an interest that would not need any protection for moral reasons. In some conventional rights might even protect interests that should not be protected, right? Or other conventional rights might protect interests that can or cannot be, or that should or should not be protected morally. But if the moral grounds of rights are interests, in what sense are individuals wronged? Are individuals wronged when their rights are violated, when no actual or morally relevant interest of theirs is at stake? So we said that rights do not necessarily protect interests of an individual right holder. We said that some rights protect interests that do not necessarily require, that are not morally significant to require that kind of protection. So why do we say that even with conventional rights, even with all kinds of conventional rights, individuals are protected whenever the rights are violated? So here's the moral magic problem. Is there maybe moral magic in the word right? What do I mean by moral magic, right? So imagine that there's a conventional right that protects some kind of trivial interest, right? That trivial interest would not deserve any protection in the state of nature, so to speak, right? Would not deserve that kind of a protection outside the convention that we are considering. Many people consider property rights of having this form, right? So if the interest that the right protects, that the conventional right protects, is morally insignificant, And sometimes it might even be an interest that the individual right holder do not care about at all. Why are individuals wrong in a morally significant sense when their rights are violated? Is there moral magic that turns this irrelevant interest into morally relevant, morally significant interest? Does the word right contain moral magic in itself? That's the issue I see here. Of course, the problem is recognized in the literature. For example, David Owens in Shaping the Normative Landscape calls these kinds of wrongs bare wrongs, the wrongs that do not affect in any sort of way the individual interests, but that are simply wrongs for the fact that they are violations of rights. And of course, there are solutions or attempts at presenting solutions from within forms of interest theory of rights. And the one I want to focus on is from a recent and very, very interesting book by Rowan Kraft, Human Right, Ownership and Individual, published last year, which is not, Kraft doesn't call his theory an interest theory of rights, but there are some aspects that I believe are typical of an interest theory of rights. Specifically, Kraft defends what he calls an addressive theory of rights. So in response to the directionality problem, to the problem of understanding why we need the language and practice of directed duties, Kraft answers that rights make it possible for individuals to relate to each other in the addressive form, you on whom I act. So when I encounter a right holder and I need to discharge a directed duty to them, the way I address them is this you on whom I act, right? They have the ability of inducing this particular conception of them in me. And similarly, as a right holder, I can relate to myself as I on whom you act, right? I can conceptualize myself as somebody who is capable of eliciting in others this kind of response. Kraft adds that some rights are natural. They protect an interest. So all rights have this kind of structure, right? All rights have this kind of addressive structure. Then some rights are natural, for which we mean that they protect an interest that we ought to protect and we ought to recognize prior to any and independently of any kind of human convention. So the Kraft uses this language of natural rights, but I guess most people would agree with this kind of definition when they talk about human rights, right? Human rights are human rights as rights that protect interests that ought to be protected if anything is to be protected, or interests that are typical, that are so typical of the human species that they ought to be protected in all kinds of circumstances, even in the state of nature, and in all kinds of conventions. Then there are rights that are purely conventional. And these rights, they do not need to protect interests that ought to deserve protection in the state of nature outside the convention. For example, property is the classic case. And of course, there might be rights that are both conventional and natural in the sense that they are conventional, they have some kind of conventional enactment and enforcement mechanism, but they protect interests that ought to be protected anyway, and so they're the sort of the conventional counterparts of natural rights. And again, conventional rights, unlike natural rights, might protect an interest that not all right holder might entertain. So the example that Kraft makes is if I have a right to property, that doesn't necessarily mean that I need to enjoy an interest, that I need to have an interest in all the property that I conventionally own. If I have his example is a stupid gnome statue, a horrible gnome statue in my garden, I might actually despise it. But insofar as the statue is mine, I have a right over it, even though I have no interest whatsoever in that kind of property. Okay, so how does Kraft address the moral magic problem, which again concerns conventional rights that are not the conventional counterparts of natural rights? So Kraft's solution is that all kinds of rights, including conventional rights, actually there's a further proviso, they have to be rights that are morally justifiable, so they are at least consistent with the rest of morality. But all kinds of rights that are consistent with the rest of morality produce a status-based interest, which he calls deontically infused good. And it consists of the interest in seeing directed duties that have myself as the recipient as fulfilled, okay? So it's actually a short passage in the book, and Kraft says, well, if we want to understand what's wrong, why is it wrongful to the right holder to violate their rights, even when they have no interest in the thing that the right is there to protect, we have to consider this idea of a deontically infused good. We all have an interest in seeing directed duties that are directed to us as fulfilled. It's a species of status interest, so it's about our status as moral agent. And we all have it, and it just calls it a deontically infused good, a good derived from a right. That's essentially the meaning of deontically infused good. Okay, so is the problem solved? Maybe if we just can see how this good can emerge. And here I sketch two proposals. Both I think are interesting, but both unfortunately fail. The first is a kind of assurance or reliance mechanism, which is what one can connect to the expectation theory of promises of somebody like Scanlon. So the idea is that rights induce a reasonable expectation for each right holder that a particular advantage that the right confers to you will be indeed delivered, will indeed materialize. So the right holder can count on the advantage that is conferred to them by the right. An example I have in mind are this. So if you're a journalist and you have the right to free speech, then you can count on it. And that counting on the right to free speech means that you know, when you have to write your journalistic piece, you don't have to think about how best to make the censors happy, and that obviously is a major advantage in your deliberation. Or if you have a right to healthcare, not health, as I wrote in the slides. If you have the right to healthcare, right, that helps you a lot in your deliberation because it gives you time, and you don't have to, you know, spend your time and energy in looking for the best health insurance for you and your family and so on and so forth. Right? So rights give you assurance. That's a possibility of trying to understand how the deontically base good can emerge. The other possible way of understanding this kind of good is by postulating an authority interest in obliging others. So David Owens, in the book I've already cited, Shaping Normative Landscape, talks of an authority interest that people have in having the right to oblige others to do certain things. And he believes that we find this right most typically in promises, that the reason why the promisee is wronged when a promise is not respected, when the terms of a promise are not respected, is because the interest that the promisee had expressed in obliging others to do certain things has been frustrated. And we can think the same thing about rights. So we can imagine this sort of good of right satisfaction. Rights serve an individual interest in being able to oblige others to do certain things as due to you. Right? So we all have an interest, again, in seeing others, in obliging others to do certain things for us, for our own sake. Okay. And that might explain, again, this status interest that Kraft identifies and that explains why all kinds of rights violation are wrongful to the right holder. But I believe that both accounts fail. The assurance account fails for at least three reasons. The first is that purely natural rights do not actually produce any assurance. For purely natural rights, I mean natural rights that have not become conventional rights yet, that have not been inscribed into the law yet, that are not have not found a conventional enforcement mechanism. They obviously don't produce this any kind of assurance, right? The second problem I see with an assurance account is that arguing that assurance by itself explains the wrongingness of the rights violation seems to me at best a very partial explanation, a very ancillary explanation, right? So maybe when we complain because our rights have been violated, one of the things we complain about is the fact that we don't have the assurance that we had before. But there's also an element of lack of respect in what has happened that might underlie our judgment that cannot be captured by this assurance aspect. And finally, and most importantly, if assurance is what we are interested in, then again, we don't need rights or indirected duties to have assurance. Assurance can be guaranteed easily, or maybe not that easily, but it can be guaranteed through a suitably constructed scheme of undirected duties. So assurance can be guaranteed in Oversphere. We just have to create a pattern of duties that make sure that people are guaranteed certain things. And if assurance is all that we are concerned with, then we have a response with the undirected duties. About this authority interest in obliging others. Okay, so how can you explain, again, why it is wrongful to the right holder to violate rights? Now, for natural rights, it is easy. Because I have an interest, a fundamental interest in certain things, then I also acquire an interest in obliging others to provide a certain thing for me. But when we consider conventional rights that are not the counterparts of natural rights, because the original interest was not morally significant, and indeed the recognition of that conventional rights is morally discretionary. Okay, so morally discretionary, I mean that certain convention might contain the protection of that interest, certain other conventions might not protect that particular interest, and we don't think that one convention is morally superior. That's what I mean, essentially, right? And so because the interest is not significant enough to ground a natural right, then when the interest is being given protection through a conventional right, why again do we say that the particular right holder is wronged, morally speaking? Moral magic? It's simply that the mere proclamation of the right has created this kind of special wrongingness that consists in the violation of the right, even though the interest that is frustrated is not an interest that the individual would have a right to in the state of nature, even though were it not for the convention, the individual would have no reason, no moral reason whatsoever to complain about the frustration of the interest. So it seems to me that the deontically infused good presented by Rowan Kraft cannot ultimately solve the moral magic problem. Now, I think that the moral magic problem ultimately affects some other accounts that are not purely interest-based. Now, there's another very common conception of rights. There's another very common way of explaining rights that relates to human beings. It all goes back to that paper by Joel Feinberg, who says in a very famous passage of the paper, the activity of claiming makes for self-respect and respect for others, give a sense to the notion of personal dignity, and distinguishes this otherwise morally flawed world from the even worse world of nowhere's world. So when Feinberg talks about claiming here, the claiming is important because Feinberg argues that all the rights are valid claims. Okay, so if we want to understand rights, essentially we have to refer to this notion of valid claim. It's a valid claim that I can articulate towards others, and that others have to understand it's a valid request from me that can generate duties to them. And Feinberg believes, and of course it's a very intuitively compelling idea, that this ability of claiming, this activity of claiming, the ability of claiming certain things as owed to us is a crucial component of our personal dignity. And again, there's been a progress in dignity-based accounts. Ariel Zilberman has recently suggested that human dignity is a relational status. So human dignity is not an intrinsic feature of human rights, it's a relational status. And it derives from the possibility of being the recipient of directed duties. Okay, so rights, again, it might seem from this account that rights matter because it's only by being a possible recipient of directed duties that I can have dignity. So the problem I see here is that, again, let's consider purely conventional trivial rights that do not protect fundamental human interest. And let's consider the difference between the ability to claim rights in general and the ability to claim a specific right, a specific conventional right. Now, it seems to me that it's undeniable that the ability to claim rights in general, the possibility of being the recipient of certain directed duties is fundamentally is crucial to our dignity. But the ability to claim all the types of conventional rights that have us as recipient do not seem to play such a central role in our dignity, or at least that needs to be demonstrated. The fact that there is a relationship between conventional rights as such and the possibility of claiming conventional rights as such and human dignity. So if my ability to claim natural rights is not impaired, if my natural rights are respected, and respected in the sense not merely that the interest is protected, but that I can claim them as rights. Okay, so here the directionality problem is solved, because what matters is not that the interest is protected, but what matters is that I can claim the right as something that has to be provided to me. Okay, but as long as my natural rights are protected, why is my dignity affected at all by conventional rights? Unless we postulate, again, that there is moral magic in conventional rights, that they turn that by merely you know, including the word right within a certain convention or within the law, we create this kind of wronging that is the violation of the right itself. So this would be a kind of deontological moral magic that adds to the teleological moral magic of interest theory of rights. So far I've been exclusively critical, and now I want to present, as I said, a very embryonal preliminary sketch of an alternative account. It would just take me 5 minutes. Okay, so my sketch of an alternative account is based on three theses that I believe describe the language and practice of rights. The first is that rights always aim at protecting, and for rights here mean moral, conventional, legal, all kinds. Rights aim at protecting the interests that are identified as characteristic of certain types. Okay, types of what? Generally types of humans, but of course, if you believe there are natural animal rights, you will also include types of animals. If you believe that collectives can have rights or that corporate agents can have rights, again, rights, types of collectives, of corporation, and so on. And how do they protect this interest that is characteristic of this type? They do that by granting the members of these categories, so that the tokens of these types, so to speak, or somebody on their behalf in certain circumstances, with the power to demand, right, that certain things are done or are not done to them for their own sake. So what rights do is they attribute either members of these types, or if members of these types are, you know, infants or non-human animals or whatever, maybe someone on their behalf, the power to demand, okay, not necessarily the power to control the duty, but at least the power to demand that the right is respected for their own sake, that it's owed to them and not to morality in general and not to the moral community in general, that the right is respected. And I'm going to call this sort of interests that are characteristic or identifiable as characteristic of certain types as type interests, just as an offhand expression. And the second important notion is that, the second important thesis is that rights are altogether positive thing, right? They're supposed to advantage the right holder. They're supposed to create a benefit to the right holder. So they allocate benefits, but they allocate benefits to specific types, again, to types of entities, right? All women, right? If you consider women's rights, or all workers' rights, all human beings, maybe, if you consider human rights, in view of these types' interests. But they never allocate benefits to individuals as such, in view of their individual interests, right? Individual interests are irrelevant when we consider which rights those individuals are entitled to. And of course, individual interests and type interests usually overlap for each individual, but they do not necessarily coincide. I might have interests that go beyond my type interests as a token of a particular type, which might be, I don't know, an Italian citizen or a UK resident or a postdoc at UNAM and so on and so forth, right? So my type interest and my individual interest certainly overlap, but they do not coincide. Now my third thesis is that in a functioning moral community, in a moral community that is healthy and that we have no reason to criticize, every person avails herself of the practice of rights. Every person is a right holder. And of course, rights are not distributed evenly, right? For obvious reasons. But they are at least available to every individual who meets the standard that makes them belonging to a certain type, to a certain category. And then there are, of course, rights. We can call them human rights or natural rights if you follow the natural law tradition. that are distributed evenly, that belong to all individuals as such. Now, I believe that following from these three theses, we can conclude that there is an element of equality that underlies rights in general, including conventional rights. And that is because all right holders are protected in one of the relevant type interests, and all are protected equally. So all that it takes for you to become a right holder is that you are identifiably a member of a certain type, right? A member of a certain category, and as a member of that category, you are protected in the same way as all other members of that category. And the practice of rights is available to every member of the moral community. So my idea here is that rights are component, okay, are part of a set of moral property that sustain the equal moral standing of persons and that allow people to relate to each other as equal. And of course, when I say that rights are components of a set of moral properties that sustain the equal moral standing of people, I mean that there might be other deontic notions that we use similarly to relate to others as equal. Maybe promises, maybe even certain kinds of duties, but I'm not sure about that. But rights most certainly are of this kind. And I tend to believe, but of course I want to hear your feedback on this, that this might finally solve the moral magic problem.
Sorry, you have like five more minutes?
Oh, I would need less than that. Don't worry. So why do I believe that I might have find a solution to the moral magic problem? Well, because, just to reiterate, the moral magic problem was about identifying the wrong characteristic of all kinds of rights violations, even those rights violations that do not impair an interest that is morally relevant. But if we follow the three theses I exposed before, violating a right means, on the one hand, denying that the particular individual I am violating the right to is entitled to the benefit derived from the type interest that is relevant to a type that the individual belongs to, right? So when I violate somebody's rights, I do not conceive that person as a person that is entitled to the benefits that people of that type are usually entitled to, right? In view of the type interest that they possess. And secondly, it means denying that an individual has the power to demand that certain things are done or are not done to them for their own sake. So in other words, it means separating the victim of one's violation from the realm of individuals that are protected by a given right. Okay? And this, I think, might explain in particular why violating a right is discriminatory, because it means separating a particular right holder from the sphere of the right holders that are usually entitled to that right. And secondly, it means treating that person as inferior, right, to both oneself and to all the other members of the moral community who avail themselves of the practice of rights, right? Because as I said before, in a functioning moral community, the notion of rights is at least available to everyone. So that explains, at least to me, why even the violation of a conventional right, okay, impinges on the moral equality of persons because of these two types of fundamental wrongings, right? One about one that consists in treating the person as, in a way, separable from the other people that are usually protected by that right. So not considering that person as a type interest, as the other members of that group, and secondly, because it consists in treating that person as inferior insofar as you're happy to avail yourself of the practice of rights, but you don't recognize that in the person that you are so addressing. Okay, that's it. That was my final reflection, and I would now very welcome your feedback. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Julio. Just remind our colleagues, I will take now questions as I see them appearing to the right. Please, I cannot mute you now, so just keep one question and one reply. And then go ahead and please put yourself in the list if you have more questions. So it's perfectly fine to have more than one question. I will start with Martin Abreu, please.
Thanks. So this is a little bit to clarify the format. So one of the things that wasn't clear to me about the way you were treating rights was whether you thought that it was sufficient for somebody having a right that somebody else had some kind of directed duty towards that person. From the characterization of rights, it wasn't clear to me that this was so, but anyway, I'll tell you why this matters. So you may think, if I have directed duty, if somebody else has a directed duty towards me of any kind, then whether or not I have a related interest, the mere violation of the duty, or like the mere violation of the obligation, is something that should be morally disallowed. And insofar as the obligation is towards me, like I am wronged when the directed obligation is not satisfied. So one way of responding to the problem of the moral magic is, well, look, forget about rights and forget about, forget about interests. If I have a right that you respect my property, then you have a directed obligation to, I don't know, not enter my property, let's say. And if you fail to satisfy that obligation, then you have done something morally wrong, because in general, not doing what you're morally obligated to do is morally wrong. And insofar as that's the case, you have wronged me in some sense. So in a way, it's like, it's not mysterious why I am wronged when somebody violates my rights, even if I have no related interest. But another way of thinking of the problem of moral magic is thinking, well, if I don't have an interest, then in virtue of what is it that somebody else has a directed obligation towards me or a directed duty towards me? And that's not, that problem, that version of the problem of moral magic is not simply answered by saying, well, because they violate an obligation to you, precisely because the question is, why, in virtue of what, do you have an obligation towards me, even if there is no related interest? That's my question.
Okay, thanks a lot. In the first part of the question, if I understand correctly, you say something like that. Why don't I use that notion of directed duties as primitive when I have to explain the wronging in the violation of the right? Why do I have to consider interest at all? And you say it's not mysterious that the violation of a directed duties to me is wrongful to me, right? But my response to that is that if you take that position, then that is not a way of solving the moral magic problem. That is a way of simply postulating the moral magic problem. So you're essentially saying that because a particular authority has created an obligation that is directed to me, then then every time that obligation is frustrated, then I am wrong. That's to me a purely a kind of a semantic solution, right? You're simply calling wrong that kind of violation of the directed obligation, of the directed duty, which to me, like I said, doesn't explain the moral wrongingness of any right violation. Okay, so in a sense, that is obviously correct if you interpret the word wrong or wronging. Actually, let's distinguish between wrong and wronging. And wrong is a generally wrongful moral action, and a wronging is an action that wrongs a particular person, right? And your solution seems to be, well, if there is a directed duty, then any violation of that directed duty is by definition a wronging. Okay, so that's why I it seems to me a kind of a semantic solution, but I want to find a moral solution. I want to explain why the right holder is wrong morally in the same way as it would as he or she would be wrong morally in other circumstances with other kinds of with other types of wronging that we understand in moral theory.
Can I say something really quickly?
Yes.
So I mean, it's not like by definition violating a directed duty is wrong. It's more like, if you have a directed duty towards me, that entails that you are morally obligated to do certain things that involve me, and it just seems a general truth that violating moral obligations is prima facie morally wrong. But I mean, that's not the important thing. The important thing is whether so I was thinking that's a possible thing you can say. Like, say there is a moral obligation towards me. If that moral obligation is violated, then you did something morally wrong that involves me. So there's no interesting question as to, there's no further question as to why you wronged me or something like that. But what your reply suggests is that the second version of the problem of moral magic actually may be a better formulation of the problem. So the second version of the problem was, when there are no relevant interests, in virtue of what do other people have directed obligation towards me? Thank you.
Okay, good point. But it's very important here. You said before, well, if I have a moral directed duty to you and I violate that duty, then I certainly wrong you morally. Yes, indeed. But I'm talking about conventional rights too. So presumably, some of these directed duties are not directed moral duties, are directed conventional duties. Okay. So that's why the moral magic problem to me is so prominent, because some of these directed obligations do not have a moral content, unless we presuppose some kind of moral magic. And about this your sort of alternative formulation of the moral magic problem. So I think I need to reflect on it. Further, but sort of an immediate response I have is that if I framed it in that way, so if I frame the problem as, in virtue of what do people have a directed obligation when no interest is in place, I think there is already an answer, right? And the answer is, but the interest is not the interest of the specific right holder, is the interest of people in the position of the right holder, of generic individuals in the position of the right holders. And so even if the individuals does not have a specific interest, then the directed obligation is still in place, because the interest it protects is a generic interest. It's not an interest of that specific person. So that's the sort of, but I like I said, I want to reflect on this further, but this seems to me the immediate response.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Thank you. Next question is going to be Moisés. Moisés Baca, please.
Gracias. Thank you. My question is very simple. I understand the moral magic problem as saying something like, if a right is protecting some sort of trivial interest, then why is it wrong, morally speaking, to violate it? This is supposed to be a problem for the interest theory of rights, but I think they can simply say, well, there is an interest being violated, and that's the wrong. I mean, it might be not significant in one violation, morally speaking, but if you reply that to all conventional rights, then it does become significant. So my question would be, wouldn't it be a simple answer for the interest right theorists just to say, so long as there is an interest being violated, that is wrong, and that's it. There is no magic in that.
Good. So quick answer, I think yes, it would be an overly simple answer, because we have to consider the fact that the interest might exist, okay, even if there is no convention that protects it. And if there is no convention that protects it, then frustrating the interest is not wrongful to the right holder, okay? Or at least it's not wrongful in the same manner, okay? So we frustrate others' interests, you know, ordinarily in our common interactions with others. And not all of these frustrations of others' interests constitute wrongings to the person.
That's true, but these interests are protected by rights. That's the point. I mean, so long as the interest generates these rights, even though they are trivial, their violation might be morally wrong. Sorry, I wouldn't say anything else.
Okay, but then again, I think that saying that, you know, the interest is trivial, but because it's been protected, then its frustration becomes a wronging that wouldn't be a wronging if there wasn't the kind of protection given by the right, then it's moral magic again, at least to me.
Thank you. Axel?
Thank you so much. It's a really interesting, complicated topic. But I'm worried that in your approach, if you violate the rights of all the member of the groups, then it seems that you are not separating the person that you are wronging, right? So it's I don't know how it doesn't follow from your account that it would only be wrong to violate the right of a member of a group as long as you don't do it to the rest of the members of the group. How do you avoid such undesirable conclusion or consequence?
Okay, good. Thank you. Good point. So as I said, right? I see the sort of the equality part of the language and practice of rights has two components, right? So there's the component related to the fact that rights are always protect interests of particular types, and all of these people are protected equally. Then there's also the feature that rights are a practice that we all avail from, right? In a functioning moral community, we are all at least potential right holders, and we can't avoid being right holder. So if you sort of consistently violate the right of a particular group of people, a particular type of people that are protected by a particular right, Well, yes, in a sense, you're not violating the first component of equality, but you're still violating the second, which might mean that you're doing, and I'm happy to accept that conclusion, in fact, which might mean that you're doing something less wrong. Okay, so a consistent right violator would be less wrongful than an inconsistent right violator. Because at least the discriminatory aspect is not present.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias. Next question is Fabiola, please.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Perfect.
Yeah. Okay. I have a bunch of clarificatory questions. I'm going to ask two. And in general, well, first, a general remark is that much of what you say depend on the distinction between conventional and not conventional rights. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't always clear to me where you drew the distinction. That was one thing. And another distinction that is important is between directed and undirected duties. And it also wasn't clear to me exactly where you were drawing the distinction. And against this lack of clarity on my side, I have also two clarificatory questions, more specific. In the case of Nowersville, this is my first question. You ask us to imagine Nowersville as a place where there are only undirected duties, but not directed. And then you ask, what's wrong with Nowersville? I mean, why do we need directed? Well, that depends on how we understand directed duties. And so that's my lack of clarity. So is promising a directed duty? That's one question, because I understand why helping others is undirected. It's a duty that is not owed to anyone in particular. But promise keeping, I would think, is owed to the particular person to whom the promise was made, so I would take it is directed. I'm not sure. I don't know what you think. But if it is directed, then a lot is lost in Nowersville if there are no directed duties. So that's my first question. I didn't understand why you meant by a place in which people fulfill all their undirected duties. And what is that supposed to leave out? Whereas if promise keeping is a directed duty, then there's a lot that's being left out, I think, in our field. So that's my first question. And the second question is when you're talking about the two problems with the ITR.
Perdona, Fabiola, las reglas permiten solo hacer una pregunta.
Ah, solo una. Ah, perdón. Bueno. Entonces, me importaba más la segunda. Oh, sorry. It's just only one question. The second one was more important to me, but if there's time at the end, I'll ask the second question. Okay, sorry about that.
Okay. And I mean, in case it's not possible to answer the second question, but by all means to maybe send me an email or something. And conventional and non-conventional. Yes, it's true. I sort of relied on kind of. Sorry, I have a noise that is. Okay. Can you all hear that noise? It's a bit annoying. Sorry.
I think it's okay. Edgar's microphone. Edgar?
Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, so I sort of relied on a set kind of an intuitive distinction between conventional and non-conventional rights. And I should probably specify it a bit better. But in general, what I mean here is that on the one hand, there's rights that ought to be recognized in all kinds of circumstances and in all kinds of moral communities that we wouldn't criticize. Okay, so the rights that we want to see protected and recognized in all kinds of moral communities that we wouldn't blame. And on the other hand, there's the rights that are recognized via fewer conventions. And of course, you know, there are rights that are both conventional and non-conventional, right? Because if a moral natural right is inscribed and entrenched within a certain convention, then it's still non-conventional moral rights, but it acquires a conventional aspect and it becomes both a conventional and a non-conventional right. So for non-conventional, it essentially means natural, purely moral, okay, and that all the rights that we believe that ought to be recognized as rights in all moral communities, in all conventional communities.
Well, let me just make here a clarification. That's extremely rough for a distinction that is very important in your paper, in your presentation, because take promising. I mean, is promising conventional? Some people think it's, you assume that property is conventional. So is promising conventional? Sorry for interrupting. I mean, more precisely.
Okay, so the distinction I'm using between conventional and non-conventional is more, it's I think more basic than that. So in the sense that when people talk about the conventionality of the practice of promising, the debate is essentially whether by violating a promise you are doing something that is moral, that is immoral beyond the convention of promises, or you are violating a norm that is internal to the practice of promising. Whereas what I'm relying on is something much more basic, and I don't think I need the notion of a better way to put it. I don't think I need the notion of non-conventional. Okay, what I need is simply the notion of conventional rights, for which I mean rights that are recognized within certain conventions. Right, the law is a convention, the rules of a game are a convention, and so on and so forth. Right, and they create some laws. Some rules of game include rights, and those rights are conventional, but conventional not in the sense that they wouldn't exist were it not for the convention. They're just conventional because they're part of a convention. Okay, and then there are also, beyond these conventional rights, there are also what we may call natural or moral rights that ought to be recognized in all kinds of circumstances, and they constitute, you know, the sort of the backbone of a practice of human rights. They are the rights that protect the fundamental interests of individuals, and so on and so forth. Okay, so my distinction is I saw it as very basic, and that's why I didn't emphasize it enough. But I'm happy, obviously, to reconsider and provide a more sophisticated distinction. So thanks for that. Directed versus undirected duties. Usually the distinction in the literature is that simply a directed duty is a duty that has a direct, not a direct beneficiary, but an addressee, something that the duty is due to. And that's it. That's the only distinction between directed and undirected duty. So in is promising a directed or an indirected duty? And Feinberg himself accepts that we can imagine a practice of promising that all that includes undirected duties. And you wouldn't, maybe you wouldn't, you don't want to call it promising, you want to, you know, call it schromises or something, but it would be coextensional with the practice of promises that we have. What happens in promises? Well, what happens is that if I make an agreement with somebody, then I, if I make a promise with somebody, then I ought to respect the terms of that agreement, not because I owe it to the person, but because I want to follow the general norm that people have to respect their promises. So can Nowersville contain promises? And Feinberg's response and the response that is accepted in a good part of the literature, I think, is yes, as long as, you know, we understand promises as promises in this different way.
I find that answer deeply and I mean impossible.
Fabiola,
impossible. Just wanted to say that mm-hmm. I understand as the reply. I think it's very implausible as a reply.
Okay.
Gustavo, por favor.
Okay, thank you. Julio, I would like you to talk more about the role dignity, the concept of dignity, is playing in your theory. Usually when people talk about dignity in the context of rights, it's as a foundation of rights. Yeah. But at the same time, as you know, there is a lot of skepticism about the notion of dignity, because people say that it's a redundant concept, that it doesn't mean anything else but autonomy, or probably in your case, having a set of basic interests. Yeah. So does it mean anything else? From what you said in your talk, you were talking about not taking dignity as an intrinsic value, but as a relation. And I find relational theories of dignity problematic. Yeah, because if dignity is just a relation, if it's not if it doesn't mean to have an intrinsic value, if it's just a relation, then either it is the perception or the response to something objective, yeah, in this case, an interest, or it is something subjective. So you can attribute dignity to just anything. So can you say more about, like, what's the role that dignity is playing in your theory?
Thanks for the question. Thanks a lot. I have, I think, the same skepticism that you have about a purely relational conception of dignity. What is the role of dignity within my account? I don't know yet. In the sense that in the end of my account, when I presented the positive part of my account, which as I said is still very embryonal, I reconnected rights to equality. Okay, so which doesn't mean that equality is the ground of rights. I simply noticed how equality plays a fundamental role in the way in which we make use of the practice of life. Okay, so equality. Dignity, I sort of still have to get there. I still have to get to the place where I decide how to include dignity within this story. So in the slide where I talked about dignity, I was essentially showing why, at least to me, the dignity-based account of rights, such as that of Joel Feinberg or Ariel Zilberman, have generate the moral magic problem. So the, why the moral magic problem affects dignity theories of rights too. And that was the only, that was my interest with the theme of dignity. And yes, there's people like Ariel Zilberman that are very clear that the most interesting sense in which we understand human dignity is relational, is through the Zilberman says that directed duties create dignity. Okay, the best way to understand human dignity is by seeing individuals as possible recipients of directed duties. And as I said, I'm not sure about what I think about this account, and I'm also quite skeptical by the idea of a purely relational account of dignity. It seems that indeed the intrinsic notion of dignity is irreplaceable, and that I also agree with your point about the fact that if you allow for a purely relational account, then dignity can become something purely subjective, and I wanna avoid that. So thanks for your reflection.
Muchas gracias, Juan Espíndola.
Hi, thanks for your presentation. It was very interesting. I have one question that's perhaps clarificatory, but I'm actually not quite sure it might lead to something more interesting. But so I know that your account is still embryonic, but I wanted to hear a little bit more about what you mean by type interests. Because so I understand the whole point is that you want to move away from an account of rights that appeals to the interests of particular individuals. Right? So you want to think of more type, like generic, the generic individual. And then, but then that's the move to type interest wasn't very clear to me. So for instance, if you have, I was thinking that who gets to call what those type interests are? Because some individuals, for instance, might take issue with the way an interest is defined, and so you could say that at that moment, if somebody does take issue with the way you're sort of crafting this type interest, then you would be wronging them. So maybe there would be a way in which you still be wronging particular individuals in the way that you're defining it, right? So if you could say just a little bit more what you have in mind, because that was very clear to me.
Okay.
I don't know if that was clear.
Thanks a lot. I'm not sure my answer will completely satisfy, because like I said, that part, you know, the final part is still at the beginning. So how do you justify a type interest? Okay. How do you decide which kind of type interests exist and are morally relevant? I think it's your question. Do you let single individuals decide what their type interests are above their individual interests? If I have to give an answer now, I would say that the theory I find more plausible or interesting to pursue is some kind of Scanlonian contractualism. So you take generic individuals to but I think a problem that cannot be sorted by Scanlonian contractualism is how do you identify the type interest in the first place? How do you understand exactly what types of people, what are the interests that are typical and characteristic of certain types of individuals. And I mean, in certain cases, right, you can have like a political response, right? Be, well, there's a kind of a political deliberation process by which this is discussed, right? So a form of democratic response, right? So you let the people that are members of this group decide on what their type interests are, okay? And that would be the sort of political, democratic, deliberative response. But at the same time, I do think that there are tight interests that you cannot justify in the same way, because they are tight interests that, let's call them moral type interests. Okay? So type interests that characterize, that we can only justify from some kind of moral justificatory process. And that is the case in which I would appeal to some form of Scanlonian contractualism. But of course, I want to remain pretty much open to the possibility that there might be different moral strategies to justify type interests, and not just one. Okay, depending also on your kind of moral inclination. So the identification of the type interest might be robust with regard to various moral theories. So if you are a utilitarian, maybe you believe that there are certain type interests. If you are a contractualist, you might believe that there is a different way to justify what type interests are, and you can still agree that type interests exist. That would be my, yeah, that's the only answer I can offer now. And I'm not sure how satisfactory it is, but that's the only thing I can say now.
Biden, please.
Hi. So my question is related to Gustavo's, although my question is coming more from the position of sympathy to relational accounts. And it's that, I want to understand, I've always found something very illuminating about Feinberg's account, and I want to understand better what conflict there is between your account and anything in Feinberg's writing. Because as I recall, you had two objections to Feinberg. The first was that his account leaves something unexplained about specific rights, and the other that he leaves something unexplained about conventional rights. But I think also there's a standing risk in understanding Feinberg as offering an account in which, and I'm not sure if this is what you're up to, but of offering an account in which the notions of dignity or the power to make claims are something like unexplained primitives. When in fact, his account leaves open questions about what it is for a claim to be intelligible in a specific context, which could generate content for specific rights, and which could also generate content when it comes to conventional rights. That is, what sort of context makes it intelligible for a member of a particular polity or a particular republic or whatever to make a claim in a particular context. So so that's to say, I don't understand why his account excludes anything you go on to say in your positive account about emphasizing equality, because all of that could be also incorporated into these questions about what it is for a claim to be intelligible in a particular context. And also, I think there's a lot more available in Feinberg to generate particular content than your presentation suggested. So I want to understand better what the conflict really is.
Okay, thanks a lot. So thanks first for the suggestion. And just to be clear, I love Feinberg's account. I mean, I like that paper a lot. I think it's the starting point for any reflection about rights. And where I take issue with Feinberg is essentially about the vagueness of the final claim, which is extremely, which I find extremely evocative and intuitively compelling, but at the same time, it's not very informative. And you were suggesting a way in which it can be more informative than I have taken it to be. So, so your point is about the fact that rights create content to a particular claim, if I understood correctly, or that it makes a certain claim intelligible to the moral community.
Right, or that what makes a claim intelligible could supply our account of the content of specific rights and conventional rights. What you think is lacking in Feinberg?
What I think is lacking in Feinberg is the passage that leads from the centrality of from the centrality of making valid claims to human dignity of making valid claims to the centrality of a human dignity to making claims that relate to all kinds of conventional rights. So my point is, as I am considered as a being that is capable of making valid claims, so long as I am respected as a potential right holder, so long as I have rights in general, and so long as I have not only some rights in general, but my natural rights are protected, so long as my ability to make claims is protected in general, why does it matter that all the rights that I am conventionally assigned are respected and fulfilled? That is my sort of contention with Feinberg. But it's not a contention. As I said, it's more the identification of a missing passage within Feinberg's account. And I also think that my account could be seen as not only compatible but possibly complementary to Feinberg. That's the thing.
Muchas gracias. En 5 minutos, por favor, 2 últimas preguntas para poder acabar 5 minutos antes y poder descansar, respirar antes del informe de Pedro. Tengo una pregunta de Fabiola y una pregunta de Axel. Antes he tomado primero la de Axel, ahora voy a tomar primero la de Fabiola, si me permiten. Fabiola, por favor, puntual.
No, Axel, adelante. Ya va, casi no queda tiempo.
Axel, por favor.
How doesn't your account fall into the same problem that you identified on assurance theorems, especially the first one? Because it seems to me that what actually gives these people the power to demand that certain right is not the right itself, but the enforcement institutions. And this is something that you criticized assurance theories, and it seems to me that it applies also to your account, or am I wrong?
I'm not sure. Why does my account have the same issue? Can you please re-elaborate on that?
Because the criticism was that what gives assurance, you say, what gives assurance people like that is not the actual right, but the fact that there has to be, if there is right. And why doesn't your account have the same problem, but now regarding not assurance, but the power to demand that these things are done for their own sake? Is that better?
Okay, good point. Thanks. I probably need to elaborate more on that. In the sense that my account could, there is this common allegation with people like Honor O'Neill have defended that this kind of cynical view that which goes back, of course, to Jeremy Bentham, that, you know, natural rights are irrelevant, nonsense upon stilts and whatever, right? Because they don't guarantee because they're not enforceable and they don't give any kind of warranty to the right holder. Now, I don't particularly like that view, so I don't want to go there. At the same time, I do think that my account would suggest why rights need an enforcement mechanism to work. Okay. At the same time, I also think that my account, an account based on equality, is also capable of emphasizing why a world with rights is, all things considered, better than a world without rights, even though some of these rights are not enforced. And that is because even if a right that I am assigned to is not currently enforced, right, I can still claim that the right belong to me, and I can still demand to be treated as the kind of creature that the right is assigned to. Thanks.
Thank you.
Pues muchas gracias, Julio. Muchas gracias por la presentación y por la discusión. Muchas gracias a todos los presentes y por vernos, por todo. Solamente antes una pequeña cuestión. Hay gente que está sugiriendo mover el seminario a las 12, como siempre ha sido. Entonces, para tener una idea mejor, he puesto un Doodle. Es muy fácil, simplemente le dan a la liga, ponen su nombre y ponen el horario que le viene mejor. Así, quien tenga que tomar la decisión, o entre todos, o con base en esa información, decidimos algo. ¿Vale? Nada. Thank you very much y les veo en unos minutos, creo. Hasta luego y gracias.
Gracias.
De nada.